everyone. My name is Ashita Cabra, and I'm the founder and CEO of By Rotation, the world's first social fashion rental app. I created the platform to empower the average consumer to transform their fashion consumption habits for good. You can save money, make money, dress well, make new friends, and save the planet one rental at a time. This is our brand podcast, On Rotation, where I'm joined by inspiring members from our community.
I'm so proud to say that this podcast is brought to you by NatWest Business Banking. Whether you're thinking about starting a new business or are already running one, NatWest could help you meet your goals sooner, no matter how big or small. I know how tough it is running a business, and we are so grateful to all the other businesses and partners for their support. NatWest is here to support your business with many tools and tips. So, if you've got a big idea that you want to turn into reality, what are you waiting for? Search NatWest Startups to get started. With NatWest, tomorrow begins today. Business banking is available to eligible customers in the UK. Specific account eligibility applies.
Today, I'm joined by Connie Nam, founder and CEO of Astrid Miyu, everyone's favorite contemporary jewelry brand, whose fans include even the Beckhams. Leaving behind her career in investment banking, Connie founded the company from her kitchen table in 2012. And now, a decade later, she has more than 17 stores in the UK and US, with another 6 more to open later this year. Connie, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me.
First things first, Connie, and I'd like to ask everyone this on the show. What's currently on rotation for you?
That's a really good question. So I was traveling in Miami and New York recently, and I've been reading this book called Love and Work. So I'm obsessed with nonfiction, especially when it relates to psychology and business. So it's written by this guy called Marcus Buckingham, who kind of designed the Strength Finder. Do you know this?
I guess it reminds me of Gallup.
Yeah, exactly.
Those 36 strengths and weaknesses.
Yes, it's like a personality test, but yeah. I'm obsessed with it. And I've like rolled it out to the whole company. So the whole premise is you've got to love your job. And how you find that is through your strength. The philosophy behind this is your strength is not what you're good at, but what you're energized by. So he gives an example of a lawyer who's really good at what she does, but she's miserable while doing it. I mean, she's trained herself to be good at it, but she's not energized by it. And like, she's probably energized by something creative. And it kind of leads on to work, but also onto parenting and everything else. And I've been really inspired by this book. And I'd recommend this to anyone who's running a business or an organization or like any parents.
But okay, so this sounds like something that you're kind of rolling out to the rest of the team as well.
Yeah. So we've rolled this out actually 3 years ago during COVID. I rolled it out to the leadership team. And the whole point was to collaborate with each other and understand each other's strength, but also be aware of your weaknesses and really collaborate. And it's really working.
I love that because I remember back in finance, which you also have a career in, we would just be asked to do these tests, but there was no context.
Yeah,
it was
exactly.
Just like, do them.
Yeah,
this means you're good at this. This means you have no empathy, you know, and you're like, what? Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah
you really take cool. it and then you leave it. But we kind of reinforce this every single day. And when we do reviews with managers, people are supposed to talk about their strength, how they used it. It's to bring out more positive energy within the team.
So Connie, tell me, because I mean, it sounds like there's a whole leadership team. There's, you know, I mean, you have more than almost 20 stores now. How many, like how big is Astrid Miyu? And who is Connie Nam?
So how big is Astrid Miyu? We've got 250 people.
Wow.
Now I can say globally.
That's crazy.
Because we have a store in the US. And also like nationwide, we have been regional stores.
Mm-hmm. In the UK.
Yeah. In the UK. I've got a really strong leadership team and, you know, we're heading to open 6 more stores on top of the, we actually have 17 stores right now.
Yeah.
And on top of that, 6 more stores and wow. Some of them will be international. So that's the scale of the business at the moment. And as for Connie Nam, myself, I grew up in Seoul and the US, so I'm a third culture kid like you.
I grew up
in different cultures, always felt like not fitting in. So part of building Astrid Miyu was to build that community where everyone feels a sense of belonging. So the ethos is so similar to By Rotation. And that's why like...
We really connect.
Yes. We connected instantly,
yeah.
Even if it was through Zoom.
During COVID.
Yes, during COVID. Yeah, I grew up between two cultures. I spent most of my primary school and high school in the US, but I went to university in Korea. And then when I graduated, I joined investment banking in the Seoul office. I worked there for 2 years and then I moved to the Hong Kong office and I was doing an M&A and also IPOs for startups at that point. It was a, there was a whole like China startup boom, and that was quite inspiring for me during those times.
Is that when you sort of felt like maybe I want to be an entrepreneur and be on the other side of the table?
Yeah, I think I always wanted to start my own thing. Even when I was a kid, like I always wanted to do my own thing.
Are your parents entrepreneurs?
They're not. My dad worked for the government.
Oh, wow. So interesting. Completely different.
Yeah, completely different. He was a diplomat. That's why we moved around.
Yeah.
My mom was a typical housewife. So we had a very traditional, conservative kind of household. But I was always like very independent. I guess moving around, you kind of have to be independent. You have to be adaptable. You have to work out different situations. My parents, like, you know, like they lived in the US for an extended period of time, but they didn't grow up there. Mm-hmm. So I had to carve my own path.
Yeah.
So I think that made me quite entrepreneurial.
And that sort of just sort of lit a fire and you thought, I think I want to make my own business. Why did you decide jewelry? Did you have any training?
No, not at all.
So how do you decide that you want to be a founder of an amazing jewelry brand?
Yeah, very good question. So I always wanted to be in fashion.
That, by the way, the Beckhams love and are going to your store all the time and buying pieces for the entire family.
My favorite family. So I always wanted to be in fashion. So after I quit banking, I came to London to go to business school. So mm-hmm. I went to London Business School. And during that time, I did internships and like consulting stints with LVMH. Just thinking that I wanted to be in fashion. But I think I realized that it's not, you know, the corporate fashion that I wanted to be part of. I just wanted to start my own thing. So I started it out as a project initially, thinking, oh, I can
during
always...
During LBS?
Like, after LBS, after I graduated. Yeah. Partially because I didn't want to get a job. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, I'll test this. Like, if anything, I'll learn about e-com. I'll learn about digital marketing and all of these things. So I started it. And the inspiration behind jewelry was, I mean, the fluffy bit is like, I always loved jewelry. Mm-hmm. Like out of everything in fashion, jewelry was always something that meant something for me. It lasts longer. Mm-hmm. And my mom loves jewelry. And we used to travel a lot. And we used to always go to markets and boutiques. And we would always pick out jewelry. And that was such a memorable, like warm moment with my family. And also from a commercial point of view, like it was a much easier category to manage. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I know you do apparel, but apparel has
but the
like,
sizing yes, and all of that.
Sizing. It's,
different tastes, different trends, seasons.
Yes, yes. Sizing,
very
seasonality.
Wasteful.
Yes, wasteful as well. And also storage. There were so many considerations. So jewelry was something that I could get into, like, you know, without as much effort, I felt like at that mm-hmm. time. And if you look at the branded jewelry category, there weren't that many. The jewelry category, when I did some research, was highly fragmented, mm-hmm. whereas apparel is very brand-led. Jewelry was very much like local jeweler-led. Mm-hmm. Or like if you wanted something fashionable, you'd go to Topshop, but then it would break after like one night out.
And it's not known for jewelry in particular. Yeah. It's actually more known for clothing.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
And I also didn't want that fast fashion element. And mm-hmm. and then you have the higher end Tiffany's or Cartier, which are not accessible for everyone. So I wanted to create this very accessible but high quality brand that's very fashionable and cool.
Contemporary.
Yes,
so, contemporary. So you kind of did some market segmentation, obviously.
Yes.
From your consulting kind of background, banking and consulting background.
Yes.
And you found a gap in the market.
Yeah, gap in the market. Yeah. Exactly. I guess that's where business school came into play, like 2x2 matrix, gap in the market. And
yeah. But that's what I love about both our backgrounds, because obviously now we're in the creative industries, but we're approaching it probably from a more commercial lens.
Yeah, exactly.
There's obviously storytelling involved, but we're running the businesses we're running for a particular reason.
Yeah. Kind of leading back to what I was reading, Love and Work, I would probably train myself to be analytical or like detailed, disciplined, because I was in banking and I wanted to do well. But then I was energized by the creativity. And I feel like I really found that passion and love in work now.
And you can apply those skills and the training that you receive from being a banker.
Absolutely.
Into what you're doing now.
Absolutely.
And that's what I love, the marriage between these two industries, which seem so opposite to each other.
You see so many ex-bankers starting their own businesses, and it makes sense.
Yeah, I love that. Tell me if there was like a particular moment where, or a milestone as they call it, where you felt like this is kind of a big deal, like Astrid and Miyu is going to be massive. Or was it just like many different things all accumulating over the years?
Yeah, I think it was many different things. I think the first thing was, Like, after I launched the brand, first couple of weeks, at that time, press was a big deal. Grazia shopping list.
Right,
yeah. And also, what was that? Stylist? The commuter?
Stylist magazine.
Magazine, the shopping list. We were on there within 2-3 weeks of launch.
That's crazy.
And that was massive for me. And I was like, I made it. And then the next big turning point was opening our first store in 2015. So 3 years in.
Yeah.
I opened our first store after an angel round.
Amazing.
So that was a big milestone for me.
But is that something you always wanted to do, like bricks and mortar?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Because the whole inspiration behind the brand was going to market stalls and small boutiques and having that in real life warm experience with my mom. So physical experience was so important to me.
You wanted people to come and interact with this brand that they maybe hadn't heard before.
Yeah.
Because it was a new brand.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I wanted that personality to come through, that sense of belonging.
What is the personality?
Personality.
Why is it named Astrid Miyu?
Yeah, good question. So I wanted to incorporate Western and Eastern cultures, because I grew up in like the mix of Eastern and Western cultures. And Astrid is a Swedish name and Miyu is a Japanese name. And that's where the marriage came.
Do you imagine them as two women?
Yes, they're two women.
What are they like?
Yeah, so there's a whole story behind them. So Astrid is an artist. She's an introvert. She's a thought leader in sustainability.
Love it.
She has a musician boyfriend.
Okay, wow. You've got vibes like written down.
Yes.
Love it.
And she has she also has a whole childhood story, but she grew up in a rural town in Europe, and now she lives in Brighton. And Miyu is cosmopolitan. She's half Asian, half English. She grew up in international schools
and
she traveled around. She's an entrepreneur. She lives in London.
I wonder who she is.
Yeah, so Miyu is inspired by me, but she's a cooler version. And Astrid is inspired by my sister. So
amazing.
She's a pianist and she's super creative.
This is so cool. I feel like I did not know about this.
They also have star signs behind them.
Oh my God, this is insane. Yeah. Like you planned out their entire life story.
Yes.
This is super cute. Have you done any storytelling around this as well?
No, we haven't. So it's an internal guide at the moment. And
persona.
Yeah. So we use it as persona when we open a store. Is it
is this for Astrid?
Yes.
Yeah.
Is it 80% Astrid or 50% Miyu? So we always incorporate that when we launch collections or when we open stores.
Amazing. I love that. There's the analytical framework behind everything.
Yeah, everything. Everything's got 2x2 matrix, 3 pillars, every single thing.
But sorry, so I interrupted you there. So you said, when you first launched, you had amazing press, you had this great store where you had a lot of customers coming through. Mm. Was there anything do you remember any moments really standing out for you?
Yeah, another moment is after we opened our store, Selfridges asked us to open a concession.
Amazing.
So this is after we started doing piercing. And that was a huge moment for me, because if I were to partner with any retailer, Selfridges was it.
It's well known. It's global.
Yes, yes. And I love their whole ethos, the creativity they bring out and the mix of high end and also high street.
And new brands.
Yeah. And it's very inclusive and creative.
And what about this expansion to the US? Because I guess, were you always shipping globally anyway?
Yes, we were always shipping globally. So after the UK, US was always our number two market. Mm-hmm. And back in 2019, we ran 3 different pop-ups in New York. Mm-hmm. And every time we ran pop-ups, we had queues lining up. So I knew there was a community out there.
Yeah.
So we were always going to open in 2020, but then, the
COVID.
COVID happened in 2020. So we had to hold this, hold fire until everything opened up.
So where is the Astrid Miyu store in the US?
So we're in Nolita in New York, in Manhattan. We're on Elizabeth Street.
Near Ruby Rosa, my favorite area ever.
it's pretty amazing.
Such a great spot.
Yeah.
Is that more for Miyu or Astrid?
I would say it's more Miyu.
Yeah.
More Miyu. Yeah.
I definitely think I'm probably more Miyu.
Yeah, I think so too.
I could see myself there.
Yeah, and I would say somewhere like Williamsburg would be more Astrid.
Yeah.
I'd say.
And I'm sure there's some plans to expand across the US further.
Yes. Yeah.
That's so exciting, because obviously Birotation has now launched in the US as well.
Yeah, that's so exciting.
And I just love that we share the same core values and our brand, both our brands are already doing a lot of partnerships together, be that in London or in Edinburgh, and I'm sure very soon in New York as well.
Yeah, and I love our American audience and our community. There's so much positivity and they're so friendly. I love them.
Do you ever think it's different from the British audience?
Slightly.
Yeah.
I think they're more instantly approachable and friendly.
The Americans.
Yeah, the Americans. God,
everyone was so friendly when I was there recently. Yeah. It's crazy.
It's so much easier to do, I guess, business development. I just walk into a store and just say, like, hey, like, would you like to do an event? And, like, people will be really up for it. Whereas, like, here, people are a bit more reserved, I'd say.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, not that the Brits are not friendly. I think people are, like, really genuine. British people are, like, genuine.
But I guess you have to build up that relationship. You have to.
Yes. Yeah. You have to build up that trust and work a bit harder.
Yeah, and sometimes as immigrants, you just want to be given a chance and given a shot, right?
Yes, yes. I think that's it. I think America is a land of immigrants and opportunities, and you can really feel it.
Yeah. I definitely felt that air of opportunity when I was there. You know, people on the street would just randomly talk to you and be like, where's your coat from? And I'd be like, well, you can rent it on by rotation.
Yeah, people are so friendly.
Like, they really are.
Yeah, I just walked into a neighbor's like store and the founder was there and like she just invited me to like her birthday party and I was like, wow, like this is
a birthday party.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
So Connie, tell us, who is the actual you? Because you're the founder and the CEO and obviously, you know, I guess we have to be a particular way in the public eye.
Mm.
But sometimes you want to mix business with personal, like in this instance, or maybe not. I don't know. Who is the actual Connie?
Who is the actual Connie?
Yeah.
I mean, like I would say like I'm pretty much the same.
Are you tough love at work?
No, I'm not.
You're too nice at work.
I'm pretty nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. I hope that's what people would say. I think I can make hard decisions. I think it was very difficult initially when I first started the business. I think that was the most difficult thing, like, you know, dealing with difficult people and being tough. But I've learned to like gain confidence to face those. Ultimately, it's for the business, it's for the better good.
Like managing 200 employees, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure you don't even know a few of them.
Yeah, now like,
Gets onboarded and
unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would love to know every single person's name, but unfortunately that's not doable.
It's not feasible.
Yeah, it's not feasible because we also have stores outside of London that I haven't been to. But my plan is to, I'm taking all of August off. So my plan is to go around all the stores and say hi to everyone.
Are you going to tell them who you are or are you going to do a mystery shopper thing?
I think they might know.
I don't know. There could be someone who's like, clueless. Who's like,
because we do a whole onboarding whenever we open a store, and I'm either on video or like my face is there. So I think they might know.
That is very true. When you do a town hall or something, you've got so many employees as well. Yeah. It's a big team.
Yeah.
That must have been kind of interesting. Never being like an entrepreneur or founder yourself, and this is your first stint at being one. And and you know, I mean, I don't know. Did you refer to any kind of training? It sounds like you like these sort of nonfiction books. Are these the things that mostly guided you or did you have a coach?
I had an executive coach for about 2 years throughout COVID. So that's been so helpful. And she still coaches my senior leadership team.
Oh, amazing.
So that was really helpful. I read a lot of books, management books. I listen to a lot of podcasts. There is a really good podcast I've been listening to recently called Founders.
Okay, you should check this out.
Yeah, it's less about businesses, but it's about the actual founders. And it's not about recent founders, but it's about like, you know, the heritage, legacy founders. Like,
would they interview them? No, well, it's more a story about
them. Yeah, so this guy who hosts the podcast, he reads loads of books on these specific founders and just goes through them. But he's so engaging. And they're quite long episodes, but I'm like really into it.
Do you think that there are some common traits of successful leaders? Have you found some sort of pattern?
Yeah, I think everyone's really hardworking.
Yeah.
And resilient.
Resilience,
yeah. I would say. And like, yeah, fast moving.
Fast moving.
Yeah.
I think one of the things I've found is decisiveness.
Yeah.
Be that good decisions.
Yeah.
Well, like tough decisions or like nice and happy decisions.
Yes.
Like, I feel like that's one of the biggest things that I've noted in people who do make good leaders.
Yes.
Yeah. So I wanted to know, we've been talking a little bit about, I guess, you know, having an executive coach and how you kind of founded this business as your first time stint as an entrepreneur. Is there any valuable lesson that you learned along your journey?
I think one of them is like, you just need to act on things. You can't wait for things to happen and like overanalyze, especially in a startup environment. You just need to like test in small bites and learn.
So you're not a manifester, you're a doer.
I'm a mean, I think you need to do a combination of both. You can't just manifest and sit there. You have to manifest and do stuff.
Yeah. Right. I always find that word a bit interesting, manifest. Because yeah. I think there's like this, for me, it sounds like I'm just going to dream it yeah. and wait for it to happen. But I'm very much like, no, you should dream it, but you should
yeah.
you should act on it.
Yeah, I think manifest for me, like, it means you're putting energy into a specific thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then it drives you to do things.
Yeah.
If, like, you don't do things, things don't happen.
Action is important.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, really important.
Yeah. So there's been a lot of highlights mm-hmm. for Astrid and Miyu, expanding internationally, having the Beckhams wearing your jewelry. Did you say Victoria Beckham is your favorite spice? I think I saw yes, that on your Instagram. She is.
She's always been my favorite spice.
She is very chic. She's yeah, very cool. Chic. I saw David Beckham a few weeks ago with his son at the 22, and they were like having a party full of kids. And then I felt like a cougar. And I was like, I need to go. I'm too old for this. She was there as well.
Oh,
very
she?
Chic as always. Yeah. I don't know if she was wearing Astrid Miyu, but next time I will, if I ever bump into her.
I think she's such a strong woman.
Yeah, she is.
And she's got that grit and resilience that we were talking about.
Yeah, and I'm sure there's a lot that we don't know in the public eye. Yeah. But I'm going off a tangent anyway. What I was going to say is there's been a lot of amazing, cool things happening to Astrid and Miyu. You've expanded internationally. You're opening up 6 stores this year alone. There definitely must have been a few hiccups or struggles. What are some things that you struggle with despite being very successful?
Oh, that's very kind of you. I think during the journey, the biggest thing I struggled with is because the business was growing so quickly and changing so rapidly, mm-hmm. just finding my place within the business. I mean, it sounds funny because I own the business, but, you know, like entrepreneurs start their journey because they want to be creative. They want to do things. They want to just move forward. But once you hire people that are better than you, you need to let go, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And then step away and find like another way to add value to the business. Mm-hmm. So I think that's been a constant struggle. And being a founder is very different from being a CEO. Do you agree with this?
I'm trying to delegate more and not get involved with everything.
Yeah.
But I'm not at the stage yet where I feel like I'm just the founder, not the CEO. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I'm still quite operational. I'm still quite hands-on.
Yeah.
But I can see that there's meant to be a difference.
Yeah,
As the founder, you're probably thinking of things more long-term.
Yeah. Being a founder and a CEO is like a fantastic combo, but they play quite different roles. So being a founder is more about like thinking long-term about the business. This is your life if you're an entrepreneur, right? This mm-hmm. this is not just the business.
Mm-hmm.
It's your life. You want to build something that lasts forever.
And you'll always be the founder.
Yeah.
You might not be the CEO, yes. but you'll always be the founder.
Exactly. And then being a CEO is more about running a team, making sure you motivate everyone, making sure you find a good home for everyone. So it's about other people.
Mm-hmm.
I guess like founder is more about like building your business.
Yeah.
Being a CEO is like nurturing everyone and providing opportunities for other people.
Do you think that, you know, you've kind of had to very quickly adapt and develop yourself? Because if you've never been a founder and a leader and a CEO before, you kind of just have to learn on the job, right?
Yeah, yeah. It was a steep learning curve. And I've never really, I guess when I was in banking, I was so junior. I was very removed from the senior management.
Yeah, we'd probably manage interns.
Yeah,
you're like, I'm a very manager.
Poorly, probably. You do this like overnight.
Yeah.
Anyways, you don't know what management is about,
mm-hmm.
right? I've never learned it. I've never observed it. So,
but also in banking, there's like very clear hierarchies. There's an HR department.
Yeah.
But when it's your own business, like, I mean, we don't have an HR department.
Yeah.
I don't know what stage you had someone to do people management.
Yeah, so we hired our people director in 2021.
Which is after how many employees?
That was after like 100, more than
100. Wow. Like, yeah. I mean, otherwise you were kind of managing it with your senior leadership team.
Yeah, exactly.
And so different from working in a large corporate.
Yeah,
you take these
so
things
different for
granted.
Yeah, and before I hired our people director, Lex, who's amazing, by the way, I spent so much energy on putting together like review structure and like, I don't know, promotion structure, things that I'd never really thought about and I had no exposure to. And I was like pulling my hair and teeth trying to come up with all of these frameworks.
And in the end, it was actually, you just needed to get an expert in.
Exactly.
Who knew what they were doing.
Yeah.
It's super interesting. I've really found with my own journey as well, like, I think I'm very cognizant of the fact that I'm great at some things and I'm just not very good at the other. As much as I want to learn them, you know, to keep the lights on if we ever had to, if we were in that situation. But other than that, I've just been very, very cognizant of the fact that I need to get experts in for all the things that I'm shit at, to be honest.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I think it's that self-awareness.
Yeah, that's so that you important. Need as a founder, yeah. as a leader,
yeah.
yeah, to build that team.
Yeah, and really appreciating those people that are very different from you, because it's very natural for a leader or a manager to like people that are very similar to them, but just being aware of the differences and really incentivizing those people.
It's so funny because for me, I'm very big on like having a very diverse team, like be that, yeah, you know, it doesn't just, diversity doesn't need to be just sort of, you know, your ethnicity or the color of your skin, but also like your socioeconomic background, your academic background, your professional background. And my husband was telling me, I've noticed something about you. You love people who are immigrants who just want to make it from basically nothing. And I guess that's probably somewhere I do have a bias towards, but I'm trying to be cognizant of that as well.
Mm, yeah. And I think immigrants are by definition entrepreneurs, right? Because they threw out everything that they had back home and they just like, you know, just brought themselves over.
Yeah. And they just put themselves into this new system and they're like, I'll play by your rules and I'll win by merit. And that's what I love. So what's the end goal then for Astrid and Miyu and for yourself, Connie? You know, do you want to do this forever? Do you want to list the company? You know, which idol of yours do you want wearing? I guess Victoria Beckham's already wearing the jewelry. Is there anyone else?
So with Astrid and Miyu, I want to build this for the long term. So I don't want to quickly cash out and leave, but I want to, you know, build a brand that lasts a lifetime. Someone like Louis Vuitton or Hermes. That's
amazing.
The dream.
I love that.
And as for myself personally, I want to be doing something that's a bit more philanthropic. So perhaps like stepping away from day-to-day running from Astrid Miyu eventually. Not yet. And I'm currently working on a concept called the Mission Lab, which will be launching by the time this podcast goes live.
Okay.
Where we're giving back to the society through Astrid Miyu Vehicle and setting up an Astrid Miyu Foundation.
Oh, amazing.
And also setting up an incubator. I'd love to mentor other entrepreneurs and like, if I have capacity, like set up a couple more brands.
I think that you would make an amazing mentor to budding entrepreneurs such as myself. Like I really feel that energy. And I think people will be very receptive to that. So I can't wait to see when that happens.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's too late to incubate me as your baby.
Oh, I'd love to.
So we've done a few exciting things together, a few partnerships, you know, Bi-Rotation community, Astrid and Miyu community. I feel like the communities that we've built are very similar. Like we share the same values. I think Astrid and Miyu, these two user personas that you have, would be our customers as well on Bi-Rotation,
yeah,
which
absolutely.
Is what's beautiful about it. Yeah, and it's super exciting that you guys are in the US as well, which is where we've now launched. I love that there's this whole play around jewelry and fashion, and you're also a sustainable jewelry brand. I mean, I just think it's so nice to find brands and founders that you have very similar values with. And obviously community, it's something that you've talked about, I've talked about. How important is community to you? Like, you know, for commercial reasons and also personally, why?
Yeah, it's so important. I mean, like, firstly, personal reasons. As I mentioned previously, I've always traveled back and forth as a child, and I really wanted to build my own community where I feel a sense of belonging, but everyone else does. So that's why it's so important personally. And commercially, you want those loyal customers that keep on coming back to you.
Completely. And it sort of makes sense to do it. And
yeah.
It's nice to make it inclusive as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's the shared love of beautiful, contemporary, sustainable jewelry.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's, again, like building that long-term perspective and long-term view with your customers.
Okay, I love to ask this. I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, which are less about Astrid and Miyu, less about you being a founder, maybe more a little about fashion and a different life that you could have led. What's a fashion faux pas that you remember committing?
Oh, that's a tricky question.
How many have there been?
No, like I'm always pretty like confident about my fashion choices. But one thing I really cringe about, I think it was in middle school, I used to wear dungarees and like have one of the straps off. And that really makes me cringe when I think about it.
Was that your school uniform or something?
No, it wasn't.
That was your choice?
Yeah.
That was your personal?
Yeah.
It's pretty bad.
Thanks.
I want to see some pics if you have them. And then my final question, which is to imagine yourself as a different Connie Nam, not the founder of an amazing jewelry brand. If you could be an expert in any other topic, not the ones that you are in right now, what would that be and why?
I would have loved to be an art curator, art expert. Okay. I was always into art. Like, I really wanted to go to art school.
Yeah.
Like, versus business school.
Okay, this was
coming out of high school.
Yeah. All right. So this is before banking then?
This was even before banking. Before university. Like, I was debating between going to business school or going to art school, which are completely different.
What happened?
I think, like, you know, one of my driving factors in life was trying to be independent early on. And I felt like, oh, if I chose art, like, I would have had to be dependent on my parents for a long time.
Exactly. This is
practical.
Yeah, it's, again, the very immigrant mindset, isn't it? Like, you have to fend for yourself. So choose the pragmatic, practical option.
Very, very practical.
But that was super interesting. And again, another snippet and another reason why you chose to be a founder and goes back to our immigrant upbringing. So nice to have you on the show. Connie, if people want to find you, where can they find you?
So they can find me at Connie Nam on Instagram or at Astrid Miyu.
Or at one of your stores.
Oh, yes.
Exactly. One of your many stores.
Yes.
Thank you again.
Thank you for having me. That was so fun.
For an exclusive £20 off on your next buy rotation rental, make sure to use the code ONROTATION. This code works for new and existing users for rentals over £30. Happy rotating!